I'm very grateful to be here with all of you, and I think it's amazing that, some teachers like you are, bringing this topic to the table, because I think it's a very essential one, obviously, and it's very important to think about what action we are all going to be taking and what sort of, events we can put together so that everyone feel concerned by the topic, right? So it's a really, really exciting, session that you've put together. So I'm really thrilled to be a part of it.
So much. So you have a very long list of achievements, so the student can read it. But the reason why I am so excited to have you here is actually so that the student can ask you some questions. So we have some sort of backup question to ask, but the most important. So we have just shown before you join, we have shown to the students the Soyuz chair. We have shown to the students the space orchestra, the collaboration we've done with Kid Cudi, the disaster playground, the sonic boom projects, and so now they are starting to trick on questions. So I'm going to ask to kick it off and ask you the first question. The first question is how different are science and fiction in your mind?
How different are science and fiction in my mind? I mean, I guess fiction, you can hear me, right?
Yes, we can hear you.
Yeah, so I guess for me, fiction is the opportunity to build a narrative, right? To actually like tell a story. And I think with fiction comes the potential to actually be bringing your imagination or actually, use your imagination and specifically use your radical imagination to actually like start to, find ways that this story can be, can be made inclusive or can be made, more important or more understandable to some people, say. So there is a big potential in what fiction can bring us as artists, as creative, to actually speak about really complex topic. And with that, there is a huge opportunity. So you can start building a narrative that is focused on, non-linear narrative, where there is no beginning, no end, and you can kind of like speak about, you start in one place of the journey, you arrive somewhere else, and then something else happens. But it's really an interesting place to start in terms of how you can use a method to actually communicate with your audience, right? So fiction is really interesting for me for that specific perspective. Now, science shouldn't be fiction. Science should be based on facts. Science should be based on hypothesis, property, conclusion. You do a test on, an insect or, and then you try it 100 times. And once you have done it 100 times, you can say, okay, yeah, for sure, moth like the moonlight, and when they like the moonlight, they react to the moonlight in a specific way. And that allow us, creative or anyone, to actually start building up conclusion or make decision in our lives as to whether or not we should kill a moth at night or not. You understand me? So it's a very different approach to things. And I think it becomes a big issue in our lives when, science become fiction. Or when there is this kind of like cross boundaries in a way. But at the same time, it's also an opportunity for us in fiction to look at science. So it's a bit different for me in that sense. Am I making sense? You can use fiction to communicate about science, but I don't think science should become fiction. But that's me saying this, it's up to you to make your own choices and your own decision in that, but yeah. I can see some questions, Cesar, in the chat box.
Yes, so feel free if you wanna grab any of this question you feel excited about them. This is quite a cool one. Do you think that it's the role of the government to handle aliens? So
it's a very it's an amazing question. I mean, I love that question. So is it the role of the government to to organize and to handle issues of alien invading Earth? Does such an organization make sense? So, I mean, do you mean such an organization as in government? I mean, there is many, many layers to your question. So, look, Aliens is a fascinating topic because I don't know if you know, but there is a whole process in place that is ratified at the United Nations for aliens and what to do if aliens were to arrive on our planet. So I can share that with you actually on the chat box so you can kind of like look at it afterwards. Shall I do that now or after? Maybe after.
It's up to you.
But basically, you know, there is a process. So like say from the moment where there is an alien being seen to the moment where actually it gets to be understood by a member of the public, it does indeed goes to, you know, chief scientists, you know, and then he goes to the UN, then he's becoming discussed there. And then finally he gets to the member of the public as to, you know, whether or not that is for them to kind of be involved at that point. So, you know, we have, I'm part of an institution called the SETI Institute, which is a Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence Institute, which has been funded in 1986 and by someone called Carl Sagan, who started this TV series called the Cosmos TV series, which I don't know if you watched it, but I really highly recommend. It's the early age of like green screen, and you can see Carl Sagan being inside the spaceship and kind of like interacting with all sorts, you know, aliens, planets, you know, and so forth, and kind of traveling the world. And it's an amazing thing to watch if you lack sleep and you cannot sleep, then the Cosmos TV series is amazing for that. So he started this, and a big part of the people that, you know, make decision or have started to think about the SETI Institute as part of something called the International American Astronautic, you know, Federation. So these people in this specific institution are debating, conversing, like whether or not we should communicate to members of the public, whether or not we should even communicate with ET, right? This idea that we should message or we should communicate with ET is something that is called METI, that is a specific range of science, the messaging extraterrestrial intelligence, METI, M-E-T-I. You can look on the METI Institute, there is as well the METI Institute. So SETI is about receiving signal, METI is about giving back signal. And there is a massive debate, right? Because the people that are part of SETI, the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence, just want to receive signal and listen to the world. So all the telescopes of the world are listening to signal that might be coming from outer space so that we can find some signal that maybe in this universe that has been some form of intelligence that has been able to produce a form of technology, and that technology is something that we can hear, you know, with our telescope. By the time we hear it, this civilization will be dead by 100,000 years. Right. But that is SETI, that is listening. METI is about sending a signal. It's about saying we are here. Listen, people, we are there. And that is, you know, they don't get along with each other. The people that want to message extraterrestrial intelligence and the people who receive extraterrestrial intelligence, they don't get along with each other, of course. So METI is about, like, as well, you know, what do we see, like, what signal do we use? So there is a signal called Arecibo message, which is, you know, kind of like coding, like 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2. Beep, 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 beep. So you kind of like send that in space with the hope that someone might hear it. But of course, there is ethical question. Shall we tell extraterrestrial intelligence that we are here? Why? You know, so again, like all of that has got ethical conversation. You know, there is ethicists, like there is anthropologists involved who are looking at what happened when civilization have been communicating about the fact that their location was there. You know, there is a fear effectively that if you tell people that you're there, then maybe something else might happen. So with that come like a whole series of debate and conversation. I mean, it's a fascinating question. Like nobody has really came to the ground of like what to do. But when it comes to an alien, there is a process in place. You know, first of all, we need to check that this person is really there. Again, like science coming on board, like you have to do it 3 times, 5 times, 6 times to actually really make sure that this is really the thing and that this thing is really extraterrestrial intelligence. Right. And then only member of the public are kind of being informed, but they are at the very end of the process, right?
The alien are going to think we're incredibly dumb because we have to do everything like so many times, the same thing. They're going to be like, why do you need to tell me hello 20 times? Like, I am here, hello.
Hello, I'm there, yes, totally.
I think there's a question from Alex Wong. There's a question from Vadia Samhit, who we can be before. Vadia, you wanna ask a question?
Yeah, sure. I'll deliver my question through the microphone. So my question is actually related to, first of all, thank you so much for being here. It's like an honor to talk to you. So the first question is related towards Interstellar, the movie. You know, it's kind of related towards how the course as well, and how climate change is affecting the country, right? So my question is exactly, and the music pertaining to it is done by Hans Zimmer, and the entire music is, you know, it's depicted through emotions and everything throughout the movie. So I wanted to know as well, like, how do you believe, you know, in movies like Interstellar, which are very sci-fi related, music has a role in it? How do you think music is depicted in movies like Interstellar, in which you know it really, you know, the entire story at the end of the day kind of resonates with the audience? You know, you've seen movies where yes, it is a background music, but when you actually watch Interstellar, you kind of resonate with it even more just because of its music.
Thank you so much for your question. And it's an honor for me to be with you and your presence as well. So look, amazing question here. So, you know, when there is complex issues such as communication with outer space, or when there is, you know, like what, communication with outer space, or even like kind of entering a sort of a parallel world like Interstellar, right? And kind of going through spaghettification, you know, all of this, there is so many layers of complexity there. I think music and like fiction in a way, or narrative, becomes a method in itself for us creative to kind of like try to communicate really complex ideas. So music for me is so essential because, you know, I would collaborate with pop artists, musicians that are, you know, have already their audience. You know, like if you think about someone like the Avalanches, which is kind of like electro music, they will come with a big audience of people that follow them, that listen to their music, and, you know, and kind of like just listen to it, like on a very simple manner, like, you know, listening to a beat and kind of reacting to it. So some people will just listen to the beats and react to it. And some people will kind of dive in a bit further and want to know a bit more about how this music was put together. And when they dive in a bit further, they hear that actually in the Avalanches, I don't know if you know that, Ben, but in the Avalanches' latest record, for example, they use some sonifications, they use some music that came from outer space that we got them provided with from telescopes. Or they use as well sonification of message that we send in outer space as well. So like when the Voyager record was sent in outer space, there was a signal, you know, when this capsule was sent in outer space, there was like some music in there. We got them access to the music, and that made it into one of their samples to bring their music together. So, you know, you can start diving into the layer of actually what it took to make that piece of music. So you can start communicating and bridging some really complex ideas by using very popular music, you know, in that sense. So I agree with you completely that music is a fascinating method. And I use that in every single project I do, because music is by definition the kind of the gateway, the enter piece to, you know, kind of like bringing a new audience to be interested and fascinated about like complex topic. So when I did Disaster Playground, which is a movie about asteroid impacting the planet, I collaborated with Headbanger Records, which is a Headbanger Record. They are like a record label in Paris, and they produce like record like Daft Punks and things like that. You know, I'm sure you know about Daft Punk, but they like, you know, again, that just meant that all of these people that follow that record label or follow Daft Punk will come to watch the movie because the music was made by their biggest, you know, band, or by the band that they were following. So, and then it became really interesting because then you bring a complete new audience to discuss about so topics such as, you know, asteroid impacting the Earth and what should we do if something like that was to happen and, you know, things like that. So it's a fascinating place to actually really speak about complex topics. And of course, the International Space Orchestra is an example of how we do this every time. Yeah, that's the Avalanche.
Yeah, you can keep talking. I was just giving some background to, giving a musical background to your conversation.
A musical background, yes.
Keep going.
You know, so here are the, so what you can see on the screen here is some NASA scientists and SETI Institute scientists, and they are basically making music, and that with them, that's the Avalanches, the bands. And this is a collaboration between the International Space Orchestra and the Avalanches. And so, of course, we are all in lockdown and we are looking at something positive that we could do together. And this music specifically, you can hear some sound that are coming again from NASA recording and NASA archive. And this is the Golden Record, which was a record that was sent in outer space, a capsule with the hope that eventually it would meet another civilization. And this is the JSC, which is a special extraterrestrial I mentioned. And then everyone, and you can see it's pretty funny, quirky, but they all top gear scientists, they're all making like really important work, like as in sending anything in outer space. It's quite a bit of fun challenge, you know. Anyway, you get the idea. And then off they are, like all making their own beat. But, you know, it's kind of like it's a feel-good movie. And at the same time, when you want to dive in, you start to understand, okay, well, it's about the galaxies, about communicating with, the galaxy and what might be out there. Then you dive in a bit further. You can see the Golden Record. You can kind of like, and then you can kind of like get into much more layer of, you know, understanding about things that are happening or people that are doing some very unique, you know, work in science in that sense.
So, thank you. Thank you so much. Music, yeah, thank you.
It's a great place. Think about music in your project for sure. And when you bring music, think about which audience you're bringing into your project. Because of course, if you're bringing the Avalanches into a project, then you're going to get the Avalanches fan base coming to your thing. If you're getting Daft Punk, you're getting the Daft Punk fan base to come into your project. So it's a really, and then you start to engage them into whatever you're doing at that point in time, you know.
Thanks a lot. I think there's a great question here. What kind of sci-fi movie, maybe I will translate it the way I understand it. Do you think, what kind of sci-fi movie do you think have a positive influence on people? Because a lot of them actually, you know, it's kind of like end of the world and stuff. But which one do you think actually are quite positive? You can think about it and come back to us after if you need some time to think about it.
I can tell you a film that I've seen recently that really I thought was amazing. Mm-hmm. It's called Titan.
Uh-huh.
And I don't know if you have heard about it. It's by, I need to find you the name of the, before I say something random, the name of the, yeah, Titan. What's the name of the director?
The director is Vincent Lambon.
Let's watch the trailer and then I can tell you a bit about it and what I found fascinating about this film.
She acted, the color of her heart. Her voice was soft and cool.
So it's you know, it's kind of body horror. I don't know if you know this kind of movie, body horror, and you know, that kind of style. And I love this kind of stuff because, you know, it's obviously it's fiction, but it's kind of like, it's really well made because it looks like, you know, like normal movie. But then of course, you know, the main character here has got a plague inside her brain, and she's obviously a bit twisted. And, you know, there is a big layer of violence inside this movie, but at the same time, you know, there is kind of like a unique love story kind of taking place and shape. And she gives birth to an alien in some sense. I mean, it's completely surrealistic, but I love the kind of the, again, the radical imagination in kind of like the space it brings you in, and all of the reference that are in the movie as well. Like, you know, I'm someone that I love going to a movie and understand in some sense the kind of the reference that the director has taken or has made kind of like a, how could I say this, has made an homage to, you know. And I can see, you know, things like J.J. Ballard, like, you know, the cars, you know, the crash, you know, all of these films that came way before that film. But at the same time, there is a unique directorial vision as well. There is like choreography, there is music is essential to the movie, music throughout the movie is there. And you're going to recognize that these are the kind of film that I'm really going to be diving into, because, you know, it's not specifically, I mean, it is talking about a really important topic as well. You know, it's talking about abortion, it's talking about, you know, women's rights, it's talking about, you know, and it's a very strong female character. And that I absolutely adore. You know, like, I'd rather spend a very good moment watching a woman on screen, woman or non-binary, or just someone that I've not seen before, you know, kind of like going through a journey that is just totally unique, than kind of like seeing someone that, you know, like, I don't know, an astronaut. Bruce, yeah, Bruce Willis, like kind of saving the world, exactly. So I highly, highly recommend Titan. Like, go and watch it. It really is a fascinating, like, amazing, amazing movie.
I'm going to be selfish. And before I get the students to question, I want to ask you a question as an educator. And I heard you use the sentence twice, radical imagination. How do you, you know, like, for example, like, how do you produce radical imagination? Do you need to get a punch in the gut to get radical imagination? Do you need to take some drugs? Do you need to, like, why, how do you get to the point where you have to have this kind of like mindset? How do you get to that mindset with your students?
Yeah, so I mean, radical imagination is, you know, like, radical imagination is actually, it's a sociological, you know, it's a sociological like, item in some sense. So radical imagination can be just seen as, you know, radical imagination, like, you know, activating your imagination in a radical manner. But it's also the idea of putting together sort of a collective. Here you go. I love that you can pull out things like this from your screen so that I can be helped as well on the way. You know, like, they define it, if you scroll down, this specific author defined it by saying, like, it's also the idea of putting together a collective experience in which you're going to basically offer alternative futures to your audience, right? And that to me is absolutely fascinating because it comes with this kind of like elements of where you like, I have a presentation that I can kind of like take you through if I find it on my screen. Give me 1 second. As to what are the kind of the different components that makes radical imagination. Give me 1 second, so then I find it for you. There you go. So, you know, they say, so basically Alex and Max Evan wrote this book, The Radical Imagination, where they basically went and investigated a lot of organized community, a lot of grassroots community, a lot of charities. And they looked at, you know, how they were actually proposing and offering alternative realities to their audiences. They came back with the fact that basically radical imagination is encompassed like 4 different elements, right? It's a collective experience. So it's the idea that you're gonna offer an alternative that is available for a lot of people. It's acknowledging the past and drawing from the past as well to, you know, push it forward into the present. So like the idea that you're going to be looking at what has been done before, and that's going to inform the alternative future you're going to present your audience with. So whether it's in a film, whether it is in a, you know, design piece, whether it is into the way you tell a story and so forth, this is the kind of the second element. The third element is the idea of social movements. So you're going to basically effectively build an organized community around these ideas, and you're going to try to actually activate this idea so that this this movement can actually develop ways and means by which they can fight a system in which they have inhabited, a system of oppression for most of it. And then it's in permanent movement. That is the idea. That these are the kind of the four elements that you find inside the book. So collective experience, drawing from the past, the development of a social movement, and it's in permanent movement, you know. And that to me is like the kind of the way that I like to you know, put together festivals or events, or so to look at this kind of four elements and how they're going to find themselves into the project. And I think it's important to think, so people like Arjun Appadurai, I'm just putting Arjun Appadurai, which is they are like you know, like I mean, I don't know how they would define it, anthropologist probably, or geographer, but yeah, Arjun Appadurai, they wrote a book which is about globalization. I mean, is it really well known for, you know, like, yeah, sorry, I'm like trying to remember, it's fresh in the morning, so I'm trying to remember that specific book. It's a specific book about the future, Arjun Appadurai, future as a cultural fact, that the one. There you go, let me just find you the that book so you can ever read through it. But basically in it, he looks at, you know, what makes globalization, what makes, you know, unique, I would say cultural interpretation of our world, or, and for him, it comes down to imagination, right? Imagination is the one thing that we should teach in school in a way, because this is the one thing that is about as well, you know, personal identity, but it's also the one thing that, you know, is not global by definition, you know? And so for me, it's kind of like, if you can tap into this idea of, you know, radical imagination, if you can start to activate that into your communities, then you have a chance to actually develop a social movement that will mean that people are gonna be engaged with a topic such as, you know, I don't know, such as, you know, climate change or other, in order to activate into the audience the notion that we need to take action, you're going to need to activate their radical imagination so that they feel concerned, they feel that they have to, they should take part, that they have a stake in it, and so forth. So then it comes with, you know, like I mentioned, these four elements, the collective experience, acknowledging the past, developing a social movement, so actually really looking at how do you organize community, building like, you know, grassroots organization, doing all of that stuff, you know. And then at the same time, also the idea of what was the last one before I forget and my brain is fried, and it's in permanent movement. And that I love about radical imagination, the idea that nothing is static. You know, at this point in time in history, and in a way, this is the thing about being creative, right? I'm not a scientist. I don't have to come up with a truth, one truth. I can come up with multiple truths with an S. I can, you know, for me, this notion of plurality is also essential to the way I think about things. This notion that there is not one truth, there is multiple truths, that there is so many different opinions, and that they are, you know, they are never stuck in one place. They are always in permanent movement. And so it's about trying to like find ways to actually activate this. So I can tell you, like at the moment I'm doing a festival called Tour de Moon. I don't know if you have seen this, like, but Tour de Moon in itself, the website is, the website, maybe not that one, but go to the actual website. If you go to Tour de Moon, tourdemoon.com. tourdemoon.com. Okay, yeah, I mean, that one is, Yeah, the website in itself is a bridge of radical imagination in that sense that is like already hitting your eyes with the colors. But I will say the whole idea of this festival, which is the nationwide festival that is taking place in the UK in this summer, is about activating radical imagination and looking at the moon as a landscape and a character to start this conversation, right? And really it's about new alien aesthetics. It's about looking at new ways that we can communicate with what might be out there. You know, we are sending signal onto the moon and back through moon bounds, for example. We are looking at new ways to collaborate with other things that are out there, whether it's a tree, whether it's an insect, whether it's an alien, you know, and with that, it comes like this kind of really weird world that we are trying to inhabit or to activate or put together. That is like that is in, you know, radical imagination is in some sense as well a social practice, the way I see it. You know, it's something that allows us to actually like really start to invade members of the public with some kind of like interesting ideas or, you know, plan for action. So I can see many questions and I realize I've not listened. So even we have new ideas, only less than 1% of them can be put into practice. The major barrier, policy, hater, money. How will the world change to embrace more ideas from different individuals to create a world that we hope to build? This is completely true. You know, we exist in a system, in an oppressive system, right? The rules that have been put in place are, by definition, you know, the ones that we inherited from colonial past, and they are oppressive. Nation states these days are, wherever you go, they are developing and perpetuating this kind of oppressive system again and again and again, right? So, and that is maintained by language, that is maintained by, you know, education, that is maintained by so many different ways that we know were there when totalitarianism was there during the Second World War, or even closer to us, you know, now we're used a lot with people like Trump and others, right? So we know these systems, we've seen them. There is a great thinker like Hannah Arendt, for example, that have been writing about them. So you can, you know, you can identify them. You can kind of, and you can also work to kind of like reveal them as a, I think, as a creative to actually reveal the system to members of the public. So at least they are aware that they are there. And Hannah Arendt is someone that wrote about this in The Origin of Totalitarianism. She really tried to unravel what are the mechanics that makes oppressive system and specifically totalitarianism, you know, happen. So I agree with you that there is this context in anything you're going to do, but that's why you need to start from the grassroots level. This is where you have to start from the organized community level. So she speaks about two things. She speaks about plurality, the notion of bringing together a lot of people on the table and never supporting one ideology. So if you support one ideology, then by definition, you're going to reinforce totalitarianism, you know? Totalitarianism is focused on the idea of like one ideology rule it all. Plurality is the opposite. Plurality is about bringing so many different people on the table. So you're always being in check. You're always being challenged in your status quo and so forth, and your privilege and so forth. So that's plurality. Then she speaks about organized community. And the idea that you actually start to find a system, I mean, a structure in which you can kind of like, you know, get people to speak their truths, find their way, and so forth. And for me, it's really the event. Like for me, for example, in my practice, I design events. So I put together festival, I put together, you know, like immersive experiences, things like that, that allow, you know, this organized community to find each other, meet with each other, identify each other, but also I reveal to them a certain part of history, or I extract a moment in history and I reenact it. You know, this system, this notion of reenactment. Reenactment is a method that is used in theater or other or films to actually, you re-perform, you replay a moment in history. And of course, when you replay a moment of history, you can change the way it went, or you can kind of tell another story through that. So I use a lot of that method as well in the way I do the work. But what I'm trying to say here is like, don't wait for people to tell you what you're allowed or not allowed to do. you know, make it happen, put it together and learn along the way. Because, you know, like César or I, we didn't start our practices just like, you know, like you don't come up with like, okay, I'm doing plurality, okay, I'm doing this or that. You do it, you know, you do it again, one time, two time, two time. No, no. You try, you learn from your failure. You test out what works, what doesn't work. You know, how do you make, like, for example, everything I'm saying to you is probably completely alien because, you know, how do you make a collective experience? That in itself, a collective experience, to make a collective experience, we could spend 6 hours talking about this. Like, how do you make that happen? And one person would tell you something, another person would do it differently. And that's the beauty of it. You know, we are in a world where you can make things happen in many different ways, but the only way you as a, you know, as someone that wants to develop their practice can do it is by actually starting to test some ideas, methods, some theatrical toolkit, you know, and so forth. And then when you do that, you're gonna start learning your craft. You're gonna start learning, okay, I am, you know, I am Lam, and Lam, my way of doing things is that I'm always putting, like, I don't know, yellow in everything I do. And that's my kind of trademark, you know, I don't know, something like that. Thank you, Lam. Oh my God, you guys are the best. Is democracy the foundation? Can China make it? I mean, fascinating question again, like you're the best. So someone that speak about, you know, that speak about democracy and actually the failure of democracy, someone called Angela Davis. And I think Davis, I don't think is EI at the end. Oh my God, sorry. Apologies, everyone. I'm just like, obviously, still not altogether Davis. Oh my God, massive mistake, grammatical mistake there. Davis like this. There you go.
Davis, yeah.
Yeah. And yeah, there you go. So you should, you like, she obviously is known for talking about carceral systems. And of course, you know, the oppression system on Black people. She was an active member of Black Panther and so forth. But she also speak a lot about basically the notion as to why democracy, the way it's been maintained so far, is not the way that she think about democracy, for example. It's like democracy, the way it's been developed, is still developed by the same people for the same people, right? So there is an opportunity to actually really shift and rethink about democracy. Like, again, democracy is a notion that shouldn't be static as it is now, you know, like this idea that we, like, if you think about democracy in the Western world, like, you know, in the US or in France, for example, we can see that there is a massive, here you go, there is a massive cracks into the way that we understand democracy. So if you think about France, for example, and actually you're pulling this here about the Algerian state. If you think about France, democracy in France meant torture. Democracy in France meant colonization of Algeria. Democracy in France meant the non-recognition of these tortures. Democracy in France meant discrimination against people, where some people were given the French citizenship, some people, because they were Arabs, weren't given the French citizenship. You know, it's this is what democracy is in places like that, right? And so I think, in some ways, of course, when you think about China, you think, okay, like China to go there, but no, like there is an amazing opportunity for China to actually reinvent as well democracy and coming up with, like, looking at everything that was failed didn't work in places like the US or in places like France or in places like Europe, where democracy is the kind of the go-to, you know, the kind of the way that they define themselves as a political format is taking place. So yeah, I think in itself, I think that is another big piece of conversation that we can have. But I personally believe that the way we are thinking about democracy right now is really constraining. And I think we can really open it up to many, many more realm of expertise, whether it's nature, of course, like, you know, how fungi, I find it fascinating, right? I'm sure you've been reading about fungi and mushrooms. you know, but right now there is this, like, there is this book about the way of the wood white, what is it called? Wood wire fungi. I'm trying to find you that book. It's a new notion that is wood.
Oh,
wood white weather.
Okay.
The wood white weather. Right. Yeah, the wood white weather. How basically the woods are connected to each other. And then the guy that wrote about this book, also like looking at fungi, he's based in the UK actually, and he's taking people to the forest. What is his name? Can you find that, the name of that book?
I found it. Nature Journal, the guy or the lady, Thomas Crowther.
I think that must be that. And what is the name of the book? I can't remember.
Thomas
Crowther. But you should look in, like Dr. Merlin Shelker, here you go. He's the big, everyone is talking about him at the moment because
right.
He is like this one. So, how fungi make our world, here you go.
I have a crazy question, more like a thought experiment that I like to do with you.
I see. Yes.
So we have to let the student go very soon because we are running a bit over time, but thank you so much. This is really amazing. The last question I'd like to ask you is more asking you like a wish. So if I was asking you a wish, so you are in London, and if I was asking you to sort of if you could like close your eyes, and if you could tell us, if you could walk us through the streets of Shoreditch where your office is in 2100, how different is it from how it is today? Could you walk us through the streets of Shoreditch in 2100, the street that you wish to see? How does it look like? Could we do that?
Yeah, let's do that. So,
okay, everybody close your eyes. Nelly's gonna take us through the streets of Shoreditch, East London, in the year 2700.
East London, okay. So yeah. Here we are, we're going there. So there is like, first of all, my office was usually in the air because it's on top of a rooftop in a train, is actually now down below. So we are reversing all of the, you know, we've reversed everything. And actually there is basically trees everywhere, grass everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
There is, we currently have no more cars, but what I can see is a lot of young people everywhere. We currently have a new government in place, which is actually led by 18 to 25.
So the young people are the people. So,
correct. So the young people are running the show. And I'm kind of saying hello to a lot of them, you know, hello, you know, they are like kind of running it. But, you know, there is as well a really like, you know, I mean, I'm not saying like there is no old people in there. Like I'm seeing a lot of them, actually, but they are all out in the street. We are all walking together down there. And then eventually we make it down below into my office, and it's a train. It's like it's an electric train that is going to take you into a brain, someone's brain, many people's brain. Mm-hmm. And then we connect with the fungi. So we are like in the wood wide web, and everything is connected. And then I can kind of like connect back to Hong Kong. And I can actually like just press a button and just turn up and be with all of you, teleport myself with all of you. So I can have like proper in-depth conversation face to face with all of you. That would be the way I see it, but maybe it's like not the best answer, but yeah.
No, that's awesome. That's awesome. I was there. Thank you so much, Nick. That was fantastic.
Thank you so much to all of you. Have a fantastic day. And thank you so much for having me and for your fantastic questions. I hope I answer all of them.